Hello, and welcome to this presentation about linked data scopes. My name is Victor de Boer, and this is work done together with Yvette Bonestro, Marijn Kolen, and Rick Hoekstra. So, linked data scopes, what are we talking about? So first, let's look at the challenge or the opportunity that's at hand. So this starts from the observation that more and more humanities scholars deal with data. They use data sets, data manipulation tools, digital methods, digital tools to analyze these data sets and say things about them that end up in research papers. So data manipulation pipelines are becoming commonplace also in the humanities domain. And in these pipelines, we see things like classification, selection, data normalization, pre-processing steps that appear again and again. However, currently, these processing steps or manipulation steps are hardly ever reported in research output. And it's important to do this because these interactions, these data manipulation steps, they actually change the data and they sort of determine the context or the lens in which the research output is valid or not. So this is an important part of the historical research methodology to critically describe the context in which certain things are observed or true. However, there's little consensus on how we can actually represent those. So that's a starting point, is the work previously done by Marijn Kolen and Rick Hoekstra in their article Data Scopes for Digital History Research, is to define a conceptual model to talk about these so-called data scopes or data lenses. So these data scopes, as they coined the term, are a method to characterize the interaction between researchers and their data and the transformation of a cluster of data into a research instrument. Right? So this is really a core part of the research methodology. So that's really nice work. A data scope consists of five data manipulation steps that they identify. And these are a selection step, so which data sources do we consider? So this is also part of corpus forming. There's a modeling step, so how actually are different elements represented? So these can be using implicit or explicit models. Then often several normalization steps occur, for example, mapping one surface form to another. Think about dates or geolocations or decapitalization, for example. And then often links are established, either internally within a dataset, but also externally to external datasets. Think about when you're using linked data as a research platform. And then classification is fifth type of manipulation, data manipulation step. How are groups, are objects grouped, or how are they categorized? And this can be done using, again, explicit or implicit conceptual schemes, concept schemes. So it's important to note that this is not a linear process, so going from one to five, but actually that this is an iterative process in which some steps might occur a lot, some steps might be not relevant, and there's different ways that you can go through these different steps. So this is a very nice research contribution, but it's a theoretical one, and it's hard to use this in practice and to point to a specific data scope, say, this is my scope. So in this work, we actually go from this qualitative conceptualization and we move to a explicit, reusable representation of data scopes. In other words, an ontology. So what we do with this is we make a data scopes machine readable, fair, and actually shareable if we use these standardized forms of describing data and ontologies. So the data scopes ontology is defined using permanent identifiers, W3ID, which point to a publicly available source. The central class is a data scope, as was in the original model. And then we see these five classes for the five data manipulation activities. So it's a fairly straightforward translation of this model. But then there are some other things like data sets, selection steps, link sets, concept schemes, which allow for a more rich representation of these data scopes. It's important to note that we also align with existing models in the domain, including Dublin Core, Prov, etc. And you can find more information at this link at the bottom of this slide. So this is a quick visualization of the ontology. So here we see the data scope element and the five elements, so selection, normalization, etc. And then we also see things like data sets, research output like papers, and we see here the mapping to prof, that all things are entities. So in that sense, we see that they are actually mapped. So how do we envision the use here? So we think about this as something, a research output that is presented next to the research paper. So a historian would do the research and then would publish the data scope or identify the data scope that would be either within a paper, but also can be an explicit representation using our ontology. And that data scope can then be linked to the paper. For example, URL to the data scope can be added. The individual elements of the data scope can be data, linked data again, like the links can be represented as link sets, but they can also be textual representations of that specific step. And what we envision is that we can actually integrate this into tooling, for example, in the Claria Media Suite, is a tool which we're developing in Claria, in the Claria project, that it could actually directly output these data scopes. So the second contribution of this work is actually a preliminary and limited validation of the model in two research domains. So we looked at two journals, one for digital humanities and one for computational social science. So what we did is we selected papers quite recent from 2018 that contained a clear data section. And then from the resulting articles, we selected randomly 2 times 15 articles, of which 6 in total were used for building the model, and then 24 were used for this validation step, 12 for each journal. We developed a set of coding guidelines, and then 2 independent coders identified the different elements in the papers, how these different elements from data scopes were represented in the text. So this is the result. So what you actually see here is that all 24 papers at least report some selection procedure. And they also all present at least one data set. And then for the other elements, we see that actually there's it often is not used or it's less used. So this shows that also shows that all elements are used in at least one paper. So that means that there are no, let's say, obsolete elements. But most papers currently do not have complete descriptions. So there's actually we claim a need for these more elaborate representations. One interesting thing is that we can actually use this also to compare different fields or different journals in this case. So we here see that the computational social science uses the elements to a higher extent compared to the digital humanities journal. So what we also did is we took these codings and actually turned them into data using this ontology. So we have 511 RDF triples describing these papers and their individual data scopes. So here in the bottom you see a snippet of that of the data set. And you can actually Sparkle against this in a public Sparkle endpoint. And that those Sparkle queries, they link to interesting competency questions such as show me the number of data sets for which a normalization step is registered. So you can test it out yourself. Of course, this is a very preliminary validation. So next steps include a large scale validation and also further refinement of the model. And then integrating it into existing tools like I also talked about in this Claria Media Suite tool, but also in, for example, tools like OpenRefine, which are very commonly used in the domain. And then one thing that we're also doing is to allowing to directly publish these things, for example, using nanopublications. So that's it for me for today. I would like to thank you all for listening. You can read more about datascopes at this URL. You can look more into the Claria Media Suite and see them pop up there at the Media Suite URL. And of course, if you have any questions or remarks, you can always send me a Twitter message or an email. And with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention, and I wish you all a very pleasant day.